Smit. I'm the Director for Standards and Technology of the International... you'll see my first slide now. Anyway, I'll continue. For the International Association of STM Publishers, and I'd like to give you the perspective from the publisher side on the data deluge that Bob mentioned. And I'd like to start with a quote by T.S. Eliot in his poem, The Rock. In that poem he wrote, "Where's the wisdom we've lost in knowledge, and where's the knowledge we've lost in information?" And would he be living now, he might add, "Where's the information we have lost in data?" Because that is actually the danger of the big data deluge. And that is because science has become very data intensive. I want to quote somebody else. That is Jim Gray, a Microsoft researcher. He died a few years ago, but before that he addressed the National Research Council, just before that actually, making them aware of how important research data were becoming. And he in fact identified four different paradigms in science. He said, millenniums ago, science at its start was very much empirical, describing natural phenomena. The last 300-400 years, so the last centuries, it's become more theoretical, using models and generalizations. The last decades, it became computational, with simulations of complex phenomena. And nowadays, it's all about data exploration. And in a way, that is was his theory, data exploration makes it possible to unify theory, experiments, simulation, etc. And the result of it is that the output of scientific work is depicted in the little pyramid you see there, with publications on the top as sort of the most summarizing, most concise form of describing the conclusions. Then there's a layer of processed data and data presentations, and under that is a bigger and bigger and bigger foundation of raw data. I think it's very important to distinguish the three layers, because many people also today were talking about either publications or raw data, but perhaps that layer in between of the processed data and the data presentations are equally important. There's a lot of raw data, but most of it that you see is already processed data. I think this morning it was John Wood who gave the example, if you summarize the most remarkable data points in an Excel sheet, then actually that is a processed data and not the complete data set. That is also important on the copyright issue, because raw data is copyright free, but the other two layers have intellectual work added, so they are actually copyrightable. Okay, this is my data deluge picture. There are many of them. This one is, in fact, I think, special because of the fact that it crosses all disciplines. Most of these pictures are for one discipline only, and that makes it difficult to compare them. This one comes from the PaaS Insight project that Herbert also mentioned. That was an EU-funded project. STM participated in it, but also CERN, Max Planck, several other big ESA, several national libraries, etc. And it was done among researchers, among funders, among data managers, and among publishers. Here you see how researchers responded to their expectation of how data sets would grow. And you see three different colors, and the light blue is what it is today. So you see that we now live, most of the data sets, two-thirds are either in the megabyte, gigabyte era. The dark blue one is what they expect it to be 2 years from now. And the white one is what it will be in 5 years. And you clearly see that the gigabyte era will reduce in those years, whereas the terabyte and even the petabyte will grow enormously. So the deluge can really be big. That is the main conclusion of this slide. What do researchers do with all these data? Where do they keep them now? Most of them just keep them at their own computer, either at home or at work or at a server of their faculty, or they keep them on a hard disk. And scaringly few send them to a digital archive. You see digital archive either in the discipline or of the organization as the lower options, and submitted with a journal to a publisher also relatively low. So let's say the places where it could be kept more persistently and curated, those are the places that presently are not used very much. There was also a question, where would researchers like to send them? And then the picture is quite different, because then you actually see that those digital archives would score very high. Also, external web services, like the cloud, and also more than 50% of the authors would like to submit the data to publishers. So, publishers in the audience, beware. Where do people go to find data? Most of them go to colleagues. That again is an expression of how little organization there is. Some go to institutional databases, general search engines, and again, formal literature is quite an important factor there. And again, it's a bit disappointing how low data centers and archives score here. Is it useful to link underlying research data with formal literature? An overwhelming yes. But do the journals to whom you submit, do they require that there's data available? No. Do you want to be credited? This is a point that Herbert also just mentioned. And there's an even more overwhelming yes. So if we come to some conclusions here, then I think it's fairly simple and straightforward to say that data and publications belong together. If we take the analogy of the deluge a bit further and the full sea of data, then you can say that publications can actually act as the beacons in that sea to make the data sets more easily retrievable, to make them discoverable. You can also say that publications are a very thorough way of presenting the metadata around the data, because it will give all the implications, the context of how the data was gathered, collected, how it can be used, how it cannot be used, etc. Because that was one of the fears among researchers to share their data. They're afraid of misuse, that people will not understand their data properly. If people always see the data in connection with a publication, one of those fears can at least be avoided or safeguarded. It's a way to give author credits, and of course, seeing it from a publisher's standpoint, it's a very good way to make the publication even more valuable, to gain depth. Well, let's look at the practice of today, because in this same PaRS Insight project, there was also a survey among publishers, and publishers were asked, can authors submit the underlying digital research data? And the majority does. You see the blue bar expressing the larger publishers of more than 50 journals, and the red ones are much smaller publishers. And in fact, even I made a little calculation on that, the 71% larger publishers who say yes actually represent more than 90% of all the journals that are being published. So far so good. And I think the best option would be if I could finish my presentation here and say that it's all well in order. But here you see the data types accepted by publishers. There's a big variety there. And this again also expresses the fact that the survey was done across many different disciplines, because each discipline tends to have its own custom and practice for certain data formats. And if we look at the way authors can submit their data, you find very common instructions. I took several from different publishers, but the most common you will find is that whatever authors send along will be published in the online version, and that they're free to submit all kinds of applications, high-resolution images, background data sets, sound clips, etc. And then most publishers also give a list of recommended file formats, and ask for good descriptive captions. But usually there's not so much more than that in the author instructions. There are also some special cases. Herbert also mentioned the nature example. Nature officially requires from every author that they make all the data available. This is a policy that goes further than most of the journals that I found. For example, a journal like Cell does more or less the opposite. They do encourage the supply of more background data, but they don't want too much. At Cell, it's very strictly limited to data sets that directly support the main conclusions. And I heard an explanation of one of the Cell people, and their rules even go so far that, for example, every graph or illustration that an author has in the article, a maximum of 7 extra graphs can be submitted, but only graphs, no raw data, and the graphs immediately have to explain that one graph in the article itself. And now, there's a special case since 2 months, and that is the Journal of Neuroscience, which will no longer accept data. So this was quite a surprise and a ripple in the community, because on the one hand, the web made it so easy to supply such stuff, and is this now a step backward? The Journal of Neuroscience doesn't want it anymore, and they want authors to put their stuff on external websites with a simple URL pointing at it. Why? They say in the editorial where they explain this decision that, yes, initially it all seemed to bring benefits to supply extra material behind articles, but they simply cannot work with the amount that they get. The volumes are growing exponentially, and it adversely affects peer review, they say. So, in short, their peer reviewers cannot handle all those amounts of data. It is simply too much. So instead, the Journal of Neuroscience asks authors to put it somewhere and to supply an external link. Such external links are not new. They've been around for quite some time, and they've merely been used for links to entities, compounds, chemical structures, stuff like that. And most journals give lists like this, as you see here, and then ask authors to link to that. And of course, one can ask, has the Journal of Neuroscience made a step back? Actually, personally, I think they're making a step forward because I expect in the data era that there will be much more initiatives like this. And later on, the two speakers after me will give you some examples of new initiatives like Pangea, DataCite, where actually such repositories are being set up for data where publishers can link to and back. So if we go back to what publishers do now, we had some questions in the Parse Insight project to publishers what they do with the data. And one of the questions was, do you validate the data submitted to you? Here you see that half do, one third doesn't, and the rest doesn't know. Again, that is very much, for me, an expression of the fact that there are not many common practices in this area yet, that there's, you know, that all kind of practices are around. And of course, then we didn't even ask what the validation actually means. You know, does it mean they just open the file to see if it works, or do they actually look at the data themselves, let alone peer review or whatever? Do publishers require the author to transfer copyright on the digital data? Close to 40% do, close to 60% don't. So again, there's not very much common practice there either. About access and use terms, are they the same as for the article? In nearly half of the cases, they are. And then you see again a very scattered picture. Perhaps I should say here that the question was not very precise, because in fact, as you saw in the Brussels Declaration of Publishers that Herbert showed, publishers agree that data should be open, and usually we say the data sets should have at least the same access and usage terms. So anybody who can be in the article should be able to seamlessly link, but other people who cannot get the article should also be able to get to the data sets. Submission of data, submitted data sets. Can others link to it? I found this the biggest surprise, because I was expecting that all publishers would allow for such links, but in fact only 44% does so far. And then a final data thing from our survey, we asked the publishers whether they have any preservation arrangements around these data. And nearly 70% do not do any preservation on the data sets, which is really scary. And perhaps even more scary is the 20% who says, yes, they do, same for publications. Well, anybody who knows a bit more about data sets knows that preservation of data sets is far more complicated than the preservation of publications. So if you actually do the same thing, it probably means you're not doing enough. Okay, then I come to my conclusions. As you can see in all the data, there's a lot of scattered practice. There's a lot of goodwill to serve authors in the best way, to allow them to submit to journals. But at the same time, journals have not worked out very well what to do with those data. There are new initiatives that point more at specialist expertise data centers to which publications can link to and through. But the good thing is that there are also many initiatives around where a lot of work has been done in getting to more best practice conventions. And I've listed a few here in which STM is active. Herbert mentioned some of the same ones. And also, if there are publishers in the room who like to know more about this or like to give input on this work, then I'm very open to that. So please approach me for that if you like. And if I can summarize from my own perspective what I think that the role for publishers should be regarding preservation of underlying research data, then I think, first of all, there should be more clarity about what authors should make available. And I say available, I don't say what they should submit, because I don't think it's necessary that authors actually hand it over to the publisher. It's good if it's linkable. More careful treatment of stuff that is submitted to publishers, because I think now perhaps not enough is done with it. Ensure at least that it is stored, curated, and preserved in trustworthy places. If publishers can supply that service by themselves, perfect. Otherwise, better to keep it to leave it to the real experts. Ensure links, establish uniform citation practices, work on common practice about peer review, and develop data publications and quality standards around it. And I think it would help if we work a lot with funders, with data centers, with libraries, etc., around that. And that is what many of the initiatives that I showed actually aim to do. So, last but not least, I think that in this data current, it's time that we take the data current, and I want to quote Shakespeare, who in Julius Caesar, I won't read the whole quote, but just the last bit, on such a full sea are we now afloat, and we must take the current when it serves or lose our ventures. I think it's time for that. Thank you.